Andrea del Sarto, called the Faultless Painter, by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Kerry Ford. But do not let us quarrel any more. No, my Lucrezia, bear with me for once. Sit down and all shall happen as you wish. You turn your face, but does it bring your heart? I'll work then for your friend's friend, never fear. Treat his own subject after his own way. Fix his own time, accept too his own price, and shut the money into the small hand when next it takes mine, will it, tenderly? Oh, I'll content him, but tomorrow, love. I often am much wearier than you think, this evening more than usual, and it seems as if, forgive now, should you let me sit here by the window with your hand in mine, and look a half hour forth on Faisal, both of one mind, as married people use, quietly, quietly, the evening through. I might get up tomorrow to my work, cheerful and fresh as ever. Let us try. Tomorrow, how you should be glad for this. Your soft hand is a woman of itself, and mind the man's bared breast she curls inside. Don't count the time lost, neither. You must serve for each of the five pictures we require. It saves a model. So, keep looking so, my serpentining beauty, rounds on rounds. How could you ever prick those perfect ears, even to put the pearl there? Oh, so sweet. My face, my moon, my everybody's moon, which everybody looks on and calls his, and I suppose is looked on by in turn, while she looks, no one's, very dear, no less. Your smile, why, there's my picture ready made. There's what we painters call our harmony, a common grayness silvers everything, all in a twilight, you and I alike. You, at the point of your first pride in me, that's gone, you know, but I, at every point, my youth, my hope, my art, being all toned down to yonder sober, pleasant Faisal. There's the bell clinking from the chapel top. That length of convent wall across the way holds the trees safer, huddled more inside. The last monk leaves the garden, days decrease, and autumn grows, autumn in everything. Eh? The whole seems to fall into a shape, as if I saw alike my work and self, and all that I was born to be and do, a twilight piece, love, we are in God's hand. How strange now looks the life he makes us lead. So free we seem, so fettered fast we are. I feel he laid the fetter, let it lie. This chamber, for example, turn your head. All that's behind us. You don't understand nor care to understand about my art, but you can hear at least when people speak. And that cartoon, the second from the door, it is the thing, love. So such things should be. Behold, Madonna, I am bold to say. I can do with my pencil what I know, what I see, what at bottom of my heart I wish for, if I ever wish so deep, do easily too, when I say perfectly. I do not boast, perhaps, yourself a judge, who listened to the legate's talk last week, and just as much they used to say in France. At any rate, 'tis easy, all of it. No sketch first, no studies, that's long past. I do what many dream of all their lives. Dream, strive to do, and agonize to do, and fail in doing. I could count 20 such on twice your fingers, and not leave this town who strive. You don't know how the others strive to paint a little thing like that you smeared, carelessly passing with your robes afloat. Yet do much less, so much less, someone says. I know his name, no matter, so much less. Well, less is more, Lucrezia. I am judged. There burns a truer light of God in them. In their vexed beating, stuffed and stopped up brain, heart or whate'er else, then goes on to prompt this low-pulsed, forthright craftsman's hand of mine. Their works drop groundward, but themselves, I know, reach many a time a heaven that's shut to me. Enter and take their place, they are sure enough, though they come back and cannot tell the world my works are nearer heaven. But I sit here, the sudden blood of these men, at a word, praise them it boils, or blame them it boils too. I, painting from myself and to myself, know what I do, am unmoved by men's blame or their praise either. Somebody's remarks, Morello's outline there is wrongly traced, his hue mistaken, what of that? Or else, rightly traced and well ordered, what of that? Speak as they please, what does the mountain care? Ah, but a man's reach should exceed his grasp, or what's a heaven for? All is silver grey, placid and perfect with my art, the worse. I know both what I want and what might gain, and yet how profitless to know, to sigh, had I been two, another and myself, our head would have overlooked the world, no doubt. Yonder's a work now of that famous youth, the urbanite who died 5 years ago, 'tis copied, George Vasari sent it me. Well, I can fancy how he did it all, pouring his soul with kings and popes to see, reaching that heaven might so replenish him above and through his art, for it gives way, that arm is wrongly put, and there again, a fault to pardon in the drawing's lines, its body, so to speak, its soul is right. He means right, that a child may understand. Still, what an arm, and I could alter it. But all the play, the insight and the stretch, out of me, and wherefore out? Had you enjoined them on me, given me soul, we might have risen to Raphael, I and you. Nay, love, you did give all I asked, I think, more than I merit, yes, by many times, but had you, oh, with the same perfect brow and perfect eyes, and more than perfect mouth, and the low voice my soul hears as a bird, the fowler's pipe, and follows to the snare, had you with these the same, but brought a mind, some woman do so, had the mouth there urged, God and glory never care for gain. The present by the future, what is that? Live for fame side by side with Agnolo. Raphael is waiting up to God, all three. I might have done it for you, so it seems. Perhaps not. All is as God overrules. Besides, incentives come from the soul's self. The rest avail not. Why do I need you? What wife had Raphael, or has Agnolo, in this world, who can do a thing, will not, and who would do it, cannot, I perceive. Yet the will's somewhat too the power. And thus we half men struggle. At the end, God, I conclude, compensates, punishes. 'Tis safer for me, if the award be strict, that I am something underrated here. Poor this long while, despised to speak the truth, I dared not, do you know, leave home all day for fear of chancing on the Paris lords. The best is when they pass and look aside. But they speak sometimes, I must bear it all. Well may they speak. That Francis, that first time, and that long festal year at Fontainebleau, I surely then could sometimes leave the ground, put on the glory Raphael's daily wear, and the humane great monarch's golden look, one finger in his beard, a twisted curl over his mouth's good mark that made the smile, one arm about my shoulder, round my neck, the jingle of his gold chain in my ear, I painted proudly with his breath on me, all his court round him seeing with his eyes. Such frank French eyes, and such a fire of souls profuse, my hand kept plying by those hearts, and best of all, this face beyond, this in the background, waiting on my work, to crown the issue with a last reward, a good tune, was it not, my kingly days? And had you not grown restless, but I know, 'tis done and past, 'twas right, my instinct said, to live the life grew, golden and not grey, and I'm the weak-eyed bat no sun should tempt, out of the grange whose four walls make this world, how could it end in any other way? You called me, and I came home to your heart. The triumph was to reach and stay there, since I reached it ere the triumph, what is lost? Let my hands frame your face and your hair's gold. You beautiful Lucrezia that are mine, Raphael did this, Andrea painted that. The Romans is the better when you pray. But still, the other's virgin was his wife. Men will excuse me. I am glad to judge both pictures in your presence clearer grows. My better fortune, I resolve to think. For, do you know, Lucrezia, as God lives, send one day Agnolo, his very self, to Raphael. I have known it all these years, when the young man was flaming out his thoughts upon a palace wall for Rome to see, too lifted up in heart because of it. Friend, there is a certain sorry little scrub goes up and down our Florence, none cares how, who, were he set to plan and execute, as you are, pricked on by your popes and kings, would bring the sweat into that brow of yours to Raphael's. And indeed, the arm is wrong, I hardly dare, yet only you to see. Give the chalk here. Quick, thus the line should go. Aye, but the soul, he's Raphael. Rub it out. Still, all I care for, if he spoke the truth, what, he? Why, who but Michael Agnolo? Do you forget already words like those? If really there was such a chance so lost, is whether you're not grateful, but more pleased. Well, let me think so. And you smile indeed. This hour has been an hour. Another smile? If you would sit thus by me every night, I would work better. Do you comprehend? I mean, that I should earn more, give you more. See, it is settled dusk now. There's a star. Morello's gone. The watch lights show the wall. The QLs speak the name we call them by. Come from the window, love. Come in, at last. Inside the melancholy little house we built to be so gay with, God is just. King Francis may forgive me. Oft at nights when I look up from the painting, eyes tired out, the walls become illumined brick from brick, distinct, instead of mortar, fierce, bright gold, that gold of his I did cement them with. Let us but love each other. Must you go? That cousin here again, he waits outside, must see you, you and not with me. Those loans, more gaming debts to pay, you smiled for that. Well, let smiles buy me. Have you more to spend, while hand and eye and somewhat of a heart are left me? Work's my wear, and what's it worth? I'll pay my fancy, only let me sit the grey remainder of the evening out. Idle, you call it, amuse perfectly. How I could paint, were I but back in France. One picture, just one more, the Virgin's face, not yours this time. I want you at my side to hear them, that is, Michael Agnolo. Judge all I do, and tell you of its worth. Will you, tomorrow, satisfy your friend? I take the subjects for his corridor. Finish the portrait out of hand there, there, and throw him in another thing or two, if he demurs. The whole should prove enough to pay for this same cousin's freak beside. What's better, and what's all I care about? Get you the 13 scudi for the rough. Love, does that please you? Ah, but what does he, the cousin? What does he to please you more? I am grown peaceful as old age tonight. I regret little. I would change still less. Since there my past life lies, why alter it? The very wrong to Francis. It is true, I took his coin, was tempted and complied, and built this house and sinned, and all is said. My father and my mother died of want. Well, had I riches of my own? You see how one gets rich. Let each one bear his lot. They were born poor, lived poor, and poor they died, and I have laboured somewhat in my time, and not been paid profusely. Some good son paint my 200 pictures. Let him try. No doubt there's something strikes a balance, yes. You love me quite enough, it seems, tonight. This must suffice me here. What would one have? In heaven, perhaps, new chances? One more chance? Four great walls in New Jerusalem, meted on each side by the angel's reed, for Leonard, Raphael, Agnolo and me to cover, the three first without a wife, while I have mine, so still they overcome, because there's still Lucrezia as I choose. Again the cousin's whistle. Go, my love. End of Andrea del Sarto. This recording is in the public domain.
Apparitions, Prologue to the Two Poets of Croesic, by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Nancy Beard, March 2, 2012, Kingston, New York. Such a starved bank of moss, till that May morn, blue ran the flash across, violets were born. Sky, what a scowl of cloud, till near and far, ray on ray split the shroud, splendid, a star. World, how it walled about, life with disgrace, till God's own smile came out. That was thy face. End of Apparitions. This recording is in the public domain.
Caliban upon Setebos, or Natural Theology in the Island, by Robert Browning. Read for LibriVox.org by Elizabeth Klett. Thou thought'st that I was altogether such an one as thyself. Will Sprawl, now that the heat of day is best, flat on his belly in the pit's much mire, with elbows wide, fists clenched to prop his chin, and, while he kicks both feet in the cool slush, and feels about his spine small eft things coarse, run in and out each arm and make him laugh, and while above his head a pompion plant, coating the cave-top as a brow its eye, creeps down to touch and tickle hair and beard, and now a flower drops with a bee inside, and now a fruit to snap at, catch and crunch, he looks out o'er yon sea, which sunbeams cross and recross till they weave a spider-web, meshes of fire, some great fish breaks at times, and talks to his own self, howe'er he please, touching that other, whom his dam called God. Because to talk about him vexes. Ha! Could he but know, and time to vex is now, when talk is safer than in winter-time. Moreover, Prosper and Miranda sleep in confidence he drudges at their task, and it is good to cheat the pair, and jibe, letting the rank tongue blossom into speech. Setebos, Setebos, and Setebos, thinketh he dwelleth the cold of the moon, thinketh he made it with the sun to match, but not the stars, the stars came otherwise, only made clouds, winds, meteors, such as that. Also this isle, what lives and grows thereon, and snaky sea which rounds and ends the same. Thinketh, it came of being ill at ease. He hated that he cannot change his cold, nor cure its ache. Hath spied an icy fish that longed to scape the rock-stream where she lived, and thaw herself within the lukewarm brine of the lazy sea her stream thrusts far amid, a crystal spike twixt two warm walls of wave. Only, she ever sickened, found repulse at the other kind of water, not her life, green dense and dim delicious bread of the sun, flounced back from bliss she was not born to breathe, and in her old bounds buried her despair, hating and loving warmth alike. So he. thinketh, he made thereat the sun, this isle, trees, and the fowls here, beast and creeping thing. Yon otter, sleek, wet, black, lithe as a leech. Yon auk, one fire eye in a ball of foam, that floats and feeds. A certain badger brown he hath watched hunt with that slant white wedge eye by moonlight. And the pie with the long tongue that pricks deep into oak-warts for a worm, and says a plain word when she finds her prize, but will not eat the ants. The ants themselves, that build a wall of seeds and settled stalks about their hole, he made all these and more, made all we see, and us, in spite, how else? He could not himself make a second self to be his mate, as well have made himself. He would not make what he mislikes or slights, an eyesore to him, or not worth his pains. But did, in envy, listlessness, or sport, make what himself would fain, in a manner, be. Weaker in most points, stronger in a few, worthy, and yet mere playthings all the while, things he admires and mocks, too. That is it. Because, so brave, so better though they be, it nothing skills if he begin to plague. Look now, I melt a gourd fruit into mash, and honeycomb and pods I have perceived, which bite like finches when they bill and kiss. Then, when froth rises bladdery, drink up all, quick, quick, till maggots scamper through my brain. Last, throw me on my back at the seeded time, and wanton, wishing I were born a bird. Put case, unable to be what I wish, I yet could make a live bird out of clay. Would not I take clay, pinch my Caliban, able to fly? For there, see, he hath wings, and great comb like the hoopoe's to admire, and there, a sting to do his foes offence, there, and I will that he begin to live, fly to yon rock-top, nip me off the horns of grigs high up that make the merry din, saucy through their veined wings, and mind me not. In which feat, if his legs snapped brittle clay, and he lay stupid-like, why, I should laugh. And if he, spying me, should fall to weep, beseech me to be good, repair his wrong, bid his poor legs smart less, or grow again. Well, as the chance were, this might take, or else not take, my fancy. I might hear his cry, and give the mannikin 3 sound legs for one, or pluck the other off, leave him like an egg, and lessened he was mine and merely clay. Were this no pleasure, lying in the time, drinking the mash, with brain become alive, making and marring clay at will? So he thinketh, such shows nor right nor wrong in him, nor kind nor cruel. He is strong, and lord. Am strong myself compared to yonder crabs that march now from the mountain to the sea. Let 20 pass, and stone the 21st. Loving not, hating not, just choosing so. Say, the first straggler that boasts purple spots shall join the file, one pincer twisted off. Say, this bruised fellow shall receive a worm, and 2 worms he whose nippers end in red, as it likes me each time I do. So he. Well then, supposeth he is good, the main, placable if his mind and ways were guessed, but rougher than his handiwork, be sure. Oh, he hath made things worthier than himself, and envieth that, so helped, such things do more than he who made them. What consoles but this? That they, unless through him, do not at all, and must submit. What other use in things? Hath cut a pipe of pithless elder-joint, that blown through gives exact the scream o' the jay, when from her wing you twitch the feathers blue. Sound this, and little birds that hate the jay flock within stone's throw, glad their foe is hurt. Put case such pipe could prattle and boast, forsooth. I catch the birds, I am the crafty thing, I make the cry my maker cannot make with his great round mouth, he must blow through mine. Would not I smash it with my foot? So he. But wherefore rough? Why cold and ill at ease? Aha, that is a question. Ask for that what knows the something over Setebos that made him, or he may be, fought and fought, worsted, drove off, and did to nothing perchance. There may be something quiet over his head, out of his reach, that feels nor joy nor grief, since both derive from weakness in some way. I joy because the quails come. Would not joy could I bring quails here when I have a mind. This quiet, all it hath a mind to, doth. Esteemeth stars the outpost of its couch, but never spends much thought nor care that way. It may look up, work up, the worse for those it works on. Careth but for Setebos the many-handed as a cuttlefish, who, making himself feared through what he does, looks up first and perceives he cannot soar to what is quiet and hath happy life. Next looks down here, and out of very spite makes this a bauble world to ape yon reel, these good things to match those as hips do grapes. 'Tis solace making baubles, aye, and sport. Himself peeped late, eyed prosper at his books, careless and lofty, lord now of the isle. Vexed, stitched a book of broad leaves, arrow-shaped, wrote thereon, he knows what, prodigious words, has peeled a wand and called it by a name. Weareth awhiles for an enchanter's robe the eyed skin of a supple ocelot, and hath an ounce sleeker than youngling mole, a four-legged serpent he makes cower and couch, now snarl, now hold its breath and mind his eye, and saith she is Miranda, and my wife. Keeps for his aerial a tall pouch-bill crane he bids go wade for fish and straight disgorge, also a sea-beast, lumpish, which he snared, blinded the eyes of, and brought somewhat tame, and split its toe-webs, and now pens the drudge in a hole o' the rock, and calls him Caliban. A bitter heart that bides its time and bites, plays thus at being prosper in a way, taketh his mirth with make-believes. So he. His dam held that the quiet made all things which Setebos vexed only. Holds not so. Who made them weak meant weakness he might vex. Had he meant other while his hand was in, why not make horny eyes no thorn could prick, or plate my scalp with bone against the snow, or overscale my flesh neath joint and joint like an orc's armour? Aye, so spoil his sport. He is the one now, only he doth all. Saith he may like, perchance, what profits him. Aye, himself loves what does him good, but why? Gets no good otherwise. This blinded beast loves whoso places flesh-meat on his nose, but had he eyes, would want no help, but hate or love just as it liked him. He hath eyes. Also it pleaseth Setebos to work, use all his hands, and exercise much craft, by no means for the love of what is worked. Tasteth himself no finer good i' the world, when all goes right in this safe summer-time, and he wants little, hungers, aches not much, then trying what to do with wit and strength. Falls to make something, piled yon pile of turfs, and squared and stuck there squares of soft white chalk, and with a fish-tooth scratched a moon on each, and set up endwise certain spikes of tree, and crowned the whole with a sloth's skull atop, found dead in the woods, too hard for one to kill. no use at all of the work, for work's soul's sake. Shall some day knock it down again. So he. Sayeth he is terrible, watch his feats in proof. One hurricane will spoil 6 good months' hope. He hath a spite against me, that I know, just as he favours prosper, who knows why. So it is, all the same, as well I find. Wove wattles half the winter, fenced them firm with stone and stake to stop she-tortoises crawling to lay their eggs here. Well, one wave, feeling the foot of him upon its neck, gaped as a snake does, lolled out its large tongue, and licked the whole labour flat. So much for spite. Saw a ball flame down late, yonder it lies, where half an hour before I slept to the shade. Often they scatter sparkles. There is force. Dug up a newt he may have envied once, and turned to stone, shut up inside a stone. Please him, and hinder this. What prosper does? Aha, if he would tell me how. Not he. There is the sport. Discover how or die. All need not die, for of the things of the isle some flee afar, some dive, some run up trees, those at his mercy. Why, they please him most when—well, never try the same way twice. Repeat what act has pleased. He may grow wroth. You must not know his ways and play him off, sure of the issue. Doth the like himself. Spareth a squirrel that it nothing fears, but steals the nut from underneath my thumb, and when I threat, bites stoutly in defence. Spareth an urchin that contrariwise curls up into a ball, pretending death for fright at my approach. The two ways please. But what would move my choler more than this, that either creature counted on its life to-morrow and next day, and all days to come, saying, forsooth, in the inmost of its heart, because he did so yesterday with me, and otherwise with such another brute, so must he do henceforth and always. I would teach the reasoning couple what must means? Doth as he likes, or wherefore lord? So he conceiveth all things will continue thus, and we shall have to live in fear of him so long as he lives, keeps his strength. No change, if he have done his best, make no new world to please him more, so leave off watching this. If he surprise not even the quiet self some strange day, or suppose grow into it as grubs grow butterflies, else here are we, and there is he, and nowhere help at all. Believeth with the life the pain shall stop. His dam held different, that after death he both plagued enemies and feasted friends, idly. He doth his worst in this our life, giving just respite lest we die through pain, saving last pain for worst, with which an end. Meanwhile the best way to scape his ire is not to seem too happy. Sees himself yonder two flies with purple films and pink bask on the Pompeian bell above. Kills both. Sees two black painful beetles roll their ball on head and tail as if to save their lives. Moves them the stick away they strive to clear. Even so, would have him misconceive. Suppose this Caliban strives hard and ails no less, and always above all else envies him. Wherefore he mainly dances on dark nights, moans in the sun, gets under holes to laugh, and never speaks his mind save housed as now. Outside, groans, curses. If he caught me here, o'erheard this speech, and asked, "What chucklest at?" Would, to appease him, cut a finger off, or of my 3 kid yearlings burn the best, or let the toothsome apples rot on tree, or push my tame beast for the orc to taste, while myself lit a fire, and made a song and sung it. What I hate, be consecrate, to celebrate thee and thy state, no mate for thee, what see for envy in poor me. Hoping the while, since evils sometimes mend, warts rub away and sores are cured with slime, that some strange day will either the quiet catch and conquer Setebos, or likelier he decrepit may doze, as good as die. What? A curtain o'er the world at once? Crickets stop hissing, not a bird. Or yes, there scuds his raven that has told him all. It was fool's play, this prattling. Ha! The wind shoulders the pillared dust, death's house o' the move, and fast invading fires begin. White blaze, a tree's head snaps, and there, his thunder follows, fool to gibe at him. Lo, lieth flat and loveth Setebos, maketh his teeth meet through his upper lip, will let those quails fly, will not eat this month one little mess of whelks, so he may scape. End of Caliban upon Setebos. This recording is in the public domain.
Cavalier Tunes by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Noel Badrian, County Offaly, Ireland. Cavalier Tunes 1. Marching Along. Kentish Sir Byng stood for his king, bidding the crop-headed parliament swing, and pressing a troop unable to stoop and see the rogues nourish and honest folks droop, marched them along 50 score strong, great-hearted gentlemen singing this song. God for King Charles, Pym and such carls, to the devil that prompts them their treasonous parles, cavaliers up, lips from the cup, hands from the pasty, nor bite take nor sup, till you're marching along 50 score strong, great-hearted gentlemen singing this song. Hampden to hell and his obsequies knell, serve Hazelrig Fiennes and young Harry as well. England good cheer, Rupert is near. Kentish and loyalists keep we not here. Marching along 50 score strong, great-hearted gentlemen singing this song. Then God for King Charles, Pym and his snarls, to the devil that pricks on such pestilent carls, hold by the right, you double your might. So onward to Nottingham, fresh for the fight. March we along 50 score strong, great-hearted gentlemen singing this song. 2. Give a rouse. King Charles, and who'll do him right now? King Charles, and who's ripe for fight now? Give a rouse, here's in hell's despite now. King Charles, who gave me the goods that went since? Who raised me the house that sank once? Who helped me to gold I spent since? Who found me in wine you drank once? King Charles, and who'll do him right now? King Charles, and who's ripe for fight now? Give a rouse, here's in hell's despite now. King Charles. To whom used my boy George quaff else, by the old fool's side that begot him? For whom did he cheer and laugh else, while Noel's damned troopers shot him? King Charles, and who'll do him right now? King Charles, and who's ripe for fight now? Give a rouse, here's in hell's despite now. King Charles. 3. Boot and saddle. Boot, saddle, to horse and away, rescue my castle before the hot day brightens to blue from its silvery grey. Boot, saddle, to horse and away, ride past the suburbs asleep as you'd say, many's the friend there will listen and pray, God's luck to gallants that strike up the lay. Boot, saddle, to horse and away. 40 miles off, like a roebuck at bay, flouts Castle Brancepeth the roundhead's array, who laughs good fellows ere this by my fay. Boot, saddle, to horse and away. Who, my wife Gertrude, that honest and gay, laughs when you talk of surrendering, nay. I've better counsellors, what counsel they? Boots, saddle, to horse and away. End of Cavalier Tunes. This recording is in the public domain.
Child Roland to the Dark Tower Came by Robert Browning. Read for LibriVox.org by Algie Pug. Perth, Western Australia. 1. My first thought was, he lied in every word, that hoary cripple, with malicious eye, askance to watch the working of his lie on mine, and mouth, scarce able to afford suppression of the glee that pursed and scored its edge, at one more victim gained thereby. 2. What else should he be set for with his staff? What, save to waylay with his lies, ensnare all travellers who might find him posted there, and ask the road? I guessed what skull-like laugh would break, what crutch gin write my epitaph for pastime in the dusty thoroughfare. 3. If at his counsel I should turn aside into that ominous tract which, all agree, hides the Dark Tower, yet acquiescingly I did turn as he pointed, neither pride nor hope rekindling at the end descried so much as gladness that some end might be. 4. What with my whole world-wide wandering, what with my search drawn out through years, my hope dwindled into a ghost not fit to cope with that obstreperous joy success would bring. I hardly tried now to rebuke the spring my heart made, finding failure in its scope. 5. As when a sick man, very near to death, seems dead indeed, and feels begin and end the tears, and takes the farewell of each friend, and hears one bid the other go, draw breath freelier outside, since all is o'er, he saith, and the blow fallen no grieving can amend. 6. While some discuss if near the other graves be room enough for this, and when a day suits best for carrying the corpse away, with care about the banners, scarves, and staves, and still the man hears all, and only craves he may not shame such tender love and stay. 7. Thus I had so long suffered in this quest, heard failure prophesied so oft, been writ so many times among the band, to wit, the knights who to the Dark Tower's search addressed their steps, that just to fail as they seemed best, and all the doubt was now, should I be fit? 7. So, quiet as despair, I turned from him, that hateful cripple, out of his highway, into the path he pointed. All the day had been a dreary one at best, and dim was settling to its close, yet shot one grim red leer to see the plain catch its astray. 9. For mark, no sooner was I fairly found, pledged to the plain, after a pace or two, than, pausing to throw backward a last view o'er the safe road, 'twas gone, grey plain all round, nothing but plain to the horizon's bound. I might go on, nought else remained to do. 10. So on I went. I think I never saw such starved, ignoble nature. Nothing throve. For flowers, as well expect a cedar grove, but cockle, spurge, according to their lore, might propagate their kind, with none to awe. You'd think a burr had been a treasure trove. 11. No, penury, inertness, and grimace, in some strange sort, were the land's portion. See, or shut your eyes, said nature peevishly. It nothing skills. I cannot help my case. 'Tis the last judgment's fire must cure this place, calcine its clods, and set my prisoners free. 12. If there pushed any ragged thistle stalk above its mates, the head was chopped. The bents were jealous else. What made those holes and rents in the docks harsh swore the leaves, bruised as to balk all hope of greenness? 'Tis a brute must walk, hashing their life out with a brute's intents. 13. As for the grass, it grew as scant as hair in leprosy. Thin, dry blades pricked the mud, which underneath looked kneaded up with blood. One stiff, blind horse, his every bone a stare, stood stupefied, however he came near, thrust out past service from the devil's stud. 14. Alive? He might be dead, for aught I know, with that red, gaunt, and colloped neck astrain, and shut eyes underneath the rusty mane. Seldom went such grotesqueness with such woe. I never saw a brute I hated so. He must be wicked to deserve such pain. 15. I shut my eyes and turned them on my heart. As a man calls for wine before he fights, I asked one draught of earlier, happier sights, ere fitly I could hope to play my part. Think first, fight afterwards, the soldier's art. One taste of the old time sets all to rights. 16. Not it. I fancied Cuthbert's reddening face beneath its garniture of curly gold. Dear fellow, till I almost felt him fold an arm in mine to fix me to the place that way he used. Alas, one night's disgrace, out went my heart's new fire and left it cold. 17. Giles, then, the soul of honour, there he stands, frank as 10 years ago when knighted first. What honest man should dare, he said, he durst. Good. But the scene shifts. Faugh! What hangman hands pin to his breast a parchment? His own bands read it. Poor traitor, spit upon and cursed. 18. Better this present than a past like that. Back, therefore, to my darkening path again. No sound, no sight, as far as I could strain. Will the night send a howlet or a bat? I asked, when something on the dismal flat came to arrest my thoughts and change their train. 19. A sudden little river crossed my path as unexpected as a serpent comes. No sluggish tide congenial to the glooms. This, as it frothed by, might have been a bath for the fiend's glowing hoof, to see the wrath of its black eddy bespate with flakes and spumes. 20. So petty, yet so spiteful. All along, low scrubby alders kneeled down over it, drenched willows flung them headlong in a fit of mute despair, a suicidal throng. The river, which had done them all the wrong, whate'er that was, rolled by, deterred no whit. 21. Which, while I forded, good saints, how I feared to set my foot upon a dead man's cheek, each step, or feel the spear I thrust to seek for hollows, tangled in his hair or beard. It may have been a water-rat I speared, but, ugh, it sounded like a baby's shriek. 22. Glad was I when I reached the other bank. Now for a better country. Vain presage. Who were the strugglers? What war did they wage? Whose savage trample thus could pad the dank soil to a plash? Toads in a poisoned tank, or wild cats in a red-hot cage. 23. The fight must so have seemed in that fell cirque. What penned them there, with all the plain to choose? No footprint leading to that horrid muse, none out of it. Mad brewage set to work their brains, no doubt. Like galley slaves, the Turk pits for his pastime Christians against Jews. 24. And more than that, a furlong on, why, there! What bad use was that engine for, that wheel, or brake, not wheel, that harrow fit to reel men's bodies out like silk, with all the air of Tophet's tool, on earth left unaware or brought to sharpen its rusty teeth of steel. 25. Then came a bit of stubbed ground, once a wood, next a marsh, it would seem, and now mere earth, desperate and done with. So a fool finds mirth, makes a thing and then mars it, till his mood changes, and off he goes, within a rude, bog, clay, and rubble, sand, and stark black dearth. 26. Now blotches rankling, coloured gay and grim, now patches where some leanness of the soils broke into moss or substances like boils. Then came some palsied oak, a cleft in him like a distorted mouth that splits its rim, gaping at death, and dies while it recoils. 27. And just as far as ever from the end, nought in the distance but the evening, nought to point my footstep further, at the thought a great black bird, Apollyon's bosom friend, sailed past, nor beat his wide wing dragon pen that brushed my cap, perchance the guide I sought. 28. For, looking up, aware I somehow grew, spite of the dusk, the plain had given place all round to mountains, with such name to grace, mere ugly heights and heaps, now stolen in view. How thus they had surprised me, solve it, you. How to get from them was no clearer case. 29. Yet half I seemed to recognize some trick of mischief happened to me, God knows when, in a bad dream, perhaps. Here ended, then, progress this way, when, in the very nick of giving up, one time more, came a click, as when a trap shuts. You're inside the den. 30. Burningly, it came on me, all at once. This was the place. Those two hills on the right crouched like two bulls locked horn in fight, while to the left a tall scalped mountain. Dunce! Dotard! A dozing of the very nonce after a life spent training for the sight. 31. What in the midst lay but the tower itself? The round squat turret, blind as the fool's heart, built of brown stone without a counterpart in the whole world. The tempest's mocking elf points to the ship, and thus the unseen shelf he strikes on, only when the timbers start. 32. Not see? Because of night, perhaps. Why, day came back again for that. Before it left, the dying sunset kindled through a cleft. The hills, like giants that are hunting, lay chin upon hand to see the game at bay. Now stab and end the creature. To the heft. 33. Not here, when noise was everywhere. It tolled, increasing like a bell. Names in my ears of all the lost adventurers, my peers, how such a one was strong, and such was bold, and such was fortunate. Yet each of old lost, lost! One moment knelled the woe of years. 34. There they stood, ranged along the hillsides, met to view the last of me, a living frame for one more picture. In a sheet of flame I saw them, and I knew them all, and yet dauntless the slughorn to my lips I set, and blew. Child Roland to the dark tower came. End of Child Roland to the Dark Tower Came by Robert Browning. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain.
Conclusion from Life and Letters of Robert Browning by Mrs. Sutherland Orr. Read for LibriVox.org by Martin Giessen. A few words must still be said upon that purport and tendency of Robert Browning's work, which has been defined by a few persons and felt by very many as his message. The definition has been disputed on the ground of art. We are told by Mr. Sharp, though in somewhat different words, that the poet, qua poet, cannot deliver a message such as directly addresses itself to the intellectual or moral sense, since his special appeal to us lies not through the substance, but through the form or presentment of what he has had to say. Since, therefore, by implication, in claiming for it an intellectual as distinct from an aesthetic character, we ignore its function as poetry. it is difficult to argue justly where the question at issue turns practically on the meaning of a word. Mr. Sharp would, I think, be the first to admit this, and it appears to me that in the present case he so formulates his theory as to satisfy his artistic conscience, and yet leave room for the recognition of that intellectual quality so peculiar to Mr. Browning's verse. But what one member of the aesthetic school may express with a certain reserve is proclaimed unreservedly by many more, and Mr. Sharp must forgive me if for the moment I regard him as one of these, and if I oppose his arguments in the words of another poet and critic of poetry, whose claim to the double title is, I believe, undisputed, Mr. Roden Noel. I quote from an unpublished fragment of a published article on Mr. Sharp's Life of Browning. Browning's message is an integral part of himself as writer, whether as poet, since we agree that he is a poet, were surely a too curious and vain discussion. But some of his finest things assuredly are the outcome of certain very definite personal convictions. The question, Mr. Sharp says, is not one of weighty message, but of artistic presentation. There seems to be no true contrast here. The primary concern of the artist must be with his vehicle of expression. No, not the primary concern, since the critic adds, for a poet, this vehicle is language emotioned to the white heat of rhythmic music by impassioned thought or sensation. Exactly, thought it may be. Now, part of this same thought in Browning is the message, and therefore it is part of his primary concern. It is with presentment, says Mr. Sharp, that the artist has fundamentally to concern himself. Granted, but it must surely be presentment of something. I do not understand how to separate the substance from the form in true poetry. If the message be not well delivered, it does not constitute literature. But if it be well delivered, the primary concern of the poet lay with the message after all. More cogent objection has been taken to the character of the message, as judged from a philosophic point of view. It is the expression or exposition of a vivid a priori religious faith, confirmed by positive experience, and it reflects, as such, a double order of thought, in which totally opposite mental activities are often forced into cooperation with each other. Mr. Sharp says, this time quoting from Mr. Mortimer, Scottish Art Review, December 1889. His position in regard to the thought of the age is paradoxical, if not inconsistent. He is in advance of it in every respect but one, the most important of all, the matter of fundamental principles. In these he is behind it. His processes of thought are often scientific in their precision of analysis. The sudden conclusion which he imposes upon them is transcendental and inept. This statement is relatively true. Mr. Browning's positive reasonings often do end with transcendental conclusions. They also start from transcendental premises. However closely his mind might follow the visible order of experience, he never lost what was for him the consciousness of a supreme eternal will as having existed before it. He never lost the vision of an intelligent first cause as underlying all minor systems of causation. but such weaknesses as were involved in his logical position are inherent to all the higher forms of natural theology, when once it has been erected into a dogma. As maintained by Mr. Browning, this belief held a saving clause which removed it from all dogmatic, hence all admissible grounds of controversy. The more definite or concrete conceptions of which it consists possessed no finality for even his own mind. They represented for him an absolute truth in contingent relations to it. No one felt more strongly than he the contradictions involved in any conceivable system of divine creation and government. No one knew better that every act and motive which we attribute to a supreme being is a virtual negation of his existence. He believed, nevertheless, that such a being exists, and he accepted his reflection in the mirror of the human consciousness as a necessarily false image, but one which bears witness to the truth. His works rarely indicate this condition of feeling. It was not often apparent in his conversation. The faith which he had contingently accepted became absolute for him from all practical points of view. It became subject to all the conditions of his humanity. On the ground of abstract logic, he was always ready to disavow it. The transcendental imagination and the acknowledged limits of human reason claimed the last word in its behalf. This philosophy of religion is distinctly suggested in the fifth parable of Ferishta's fancies. But even in defending what remains, from the most widely accepted point of view, the validity of Mr. Browning's message, we concede the fact that it is most powerful when conveyed in its least explicit form, for then alone does it bear, with the full weight of his poetic utterance, on the minds to which it is addressed. His challenge to faith and hope imposes itself far less through any intellectual plea which he can advance in its support, than through the unconscious testimony of all creative genius to the marvel of conscious life, through the passionate affirmation of his poetic and human nature, not only of the goodness and the beauty of that life, but of its reality and its persistence. We are told by Mr. Sharp that a new star appeared in Orion on the night on which Robert Browning died. The alleged fact is disproved by the statement of the Astronomer Royal, to whom it has been submitted. But it would have been a beautiful symbol of translation, such as affectionate fancy might gladly cherish if it were true. It is indeed true that on the 12th of December a vivid centre of light and warmth was extinguished upon our earth. The clouded brightness of many lives bears witness to the poet's spirit which has departed, the glowing human presence which has passed away. We mourn the poet whom we have lost far less than we regret the man, for he had done his appointed work, and that work remains to us. But the two beings were in truth inseparable. The man is always present in the poet. The poet was dominant in the man. This fact can never be absent from our loving remembrance of him. No just estimate of his life and character will fail to give it weight. End of conclusion from Life and Letters of Robert Browning by Mrs. Sutherland Orr. End of Robert Browning, 200th Anniversary Collection, Volume 1. De Gustibus, by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Martin Geeson, in Haslemere, Surrey. Your ghost will walk, you lover of trees, if our loves remain, in an English lane, by a cornfield side aflutter with poppies. Hark, those two in the hazel coppice, a boy and a girl, if the good fates please, making love, say, the happier they. Draw yourself up from the light of the moon, and let them pass, as they will too soon, with the bean-flower's boon, and the blackbird's tune, and May and June. What I love best in all the world is a castle, precipice encurled in a gash of the wind-grieved Apennine. Or look for me, old fellow of mine, if I get my head from out the mouth of the grave, and loose my spirit's bands, and come again to the land of lands, in a seaside house to the farther south, where the baked cicala dies of drouth, and one sharp tree, 'tis a cypress, stands, by the many hundred years red-rusted, rough iron-spiked, ripe fruit or crusted, my sentinel to guard the sands to the water's edge. For what expands before the house but the great opaque blue breadth of sea without a break? While in the house forever crumbles some fragment of the frescoed walls from blisters where a scorpion sprawls. A girl barefooted brings and tumbles down on the pavement green flesh melons, and says there's news today, the king was shot at, touched in the liver wing, goes with his Bourbon arm a sling. She hopes they have not caught the felons. Italy, my Italy! Queen Mary's saying serves for me, when fortune's malice lost her callice. Open my heart, and you will see graved inside of it, Italy. Such lovers old are I and she, so it always was, so shall ever be. End of De Gustibus. This recording is in the public domain.
Donald, by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Ginger Cuccolo. Do you happen to know in Rosshire, Mount Ben, but the name scarce matters? Of the naked fact I am sure enough, though I clothe it in rags and tatters. You may recognize Ben by description. Behind him, a moor's immenseness. Up goes the middle mount of a range, fringed with its firs and denseness. Rimming the edge, its fir fringe, mind, for an edge there is, though narrow. From end to end of the range a strip of pass runs straight as an arrow, and the mountaineer who takes that path saves himself miles of journey he has to plod if he crosses the moor through heather, peat, and burney. But a mountaineer he needs must be, for look you, right in the middle projects bluff Ben, with an end in ish. Why planted there is a riddle. Since all Ben's brothers, little and big, keep rank, set shoulder to shoulder, and only this burliest out must bulge till it seems to the beholder. From down in the gully, as if Ben's breast, to a sudden spike diminished, would signify to the boldest foot, all further passage finished. Yet the mountaineer who sidles on and on to the very bending, discovers, if heart and brain be proof, no necessary ending. Foot up, foot down, to the turn abrupt, having trod, he, there arriving, finds, what he took for a point was breadth, a mercy of nature's contriving. So he rounds what, when 'tis reached, proves straight, from one side gains the other, The wee path widens, resume the march, and he fools you, Ben, my brother. But Donald, that name I hope will do, I wrong him if I call foiling, the tramp of the callant, whistling the while, as blithe as our kettle's boiling. He had dared the danger from boyhood up, and now, when perchance was waiting a lass at the brig below, twixt mount and more would he standing debating? Moreover, this Donald was 25, a glory of bone and muscle. Did a fiend dispute the right of way, Donald would try a tussle. Lightsomely marched he out of the broad on to the narrow and narrow. A step more, rounding the angular rock, reached the front straight as an arrow. He stepped it, safe on the ledge he stood, when, whom found he full-facing? What fellow in courage and wariness, too, had scouted ignoble pacing, and left low safety to timid mates, and made for the dread deer danger, and gained the height where, who could guess, he would meet with a rival ranger? 'Twas a gold-red stag that stood and stared, gigantic and magnific. By the wonder, aye, and the peril, struck intelligent and pacific. For a red deer is no fallow deer, grown cowardly through park-feeding. He batters you like a thunderbolt if you brave his haunts unheeding. I doubt he could hardly perform volte-face had valor advised discretion. You may walk on a rope, but to turn on a rope no Blondin makes profession. Yet Donald must turn, would pride permit, though pride ill brooks retiring. Each eyed each, mute man, motionless beast, less fearing than admiring. These are the moments when quite new sense, to meet some need as novel, springs up in the brain, it inspired resource, nor advance nor retreat, but grovel. And slowly, surely, never a whit, relaxing the steady tension of eye stare which binds man to beast, by an inch declension, sank Donald sideways down and down, till flat, breast upwards, lying at his 6 foot length, no corpse more still. If he cross me, the trick's worth trying. Minutes were an eternity, but a new sense was created. In the stag's brain, too, he resolves, slow sure, with eye stare unabated. Feelingly he extends his foot, which tastes the way ere it touches, or solid and just escapes man soft, nor hold of the same unclutches, till its fellow foot, light as a feather whisk, lands itself no less finely. So a mother removes a fly from the face of her babe asleep supinely. And now 'tis the haunch and hind foot's turn. That's hard. Can the beast quite raise it? Yes, traversing half the prostrate length, his hook-tip does not graze it. Just one more lift. But Donald, you see, was sportsman first, man after. A fancy lightened his caution through. He well-nigh broke into laughter. It were nothing short of a miracle, unrivaled, unexampled. All sporting feats with this feat matched were down and dead and trampled. The last of the legs as tenderly follows the rest, or never, or now is the time. His knife in reach, and his right hand loose, how clever. For this can stab up the stomach soft, while the left hand grasps the pastern. Arise on the elbow, and now's the time, or never, this turn's the last turn. I shall dare to place myself by God, who scanned, for he does, each feature of the face thrown up in appeal to him by the agonizing creature. Nay, I hear plain words, thy gift brings this. Up he sprang, back he staggered, over he fell, and with him our friend, at following game, no laggard. Yet he was not dead when they picked next day, from the gully's depth, the wreck of him. His fall had been stayed by the stag beneath, who cushioned and saved the neck of him. But the rest of his body, why, doctor said, whatever could break was broken. legs, arms, ribs, all of him looked like a toast in a tumbler of port wine soaking. "That your life is left you, thank the stag," said they when the slow cure ended. They opened the hospital door and thence strap, spliced, main fractures mended, and minor damage left wisely alone, like an old shoe clouded and cobbled. Out what went in a Goliath well nigh, some half of a David hobbled. You must ask an alms from house to house, sell the stag's head for a bracket. With its grand 12 tines, I'd buy it myself and use the skin for a jacket. He was wiser, made both head and hide, his windpenny, hands and knees on, would manage to crawl, poor crab, by the roads in the misty stalking season. And if he discovered a bothy like this, why, harvest was sure. Folk listened. He told his tale to the lovers of sport. Lips twitched, cheeks glowed, eyes glistened. And when he had come to the close and spread his spoils for the gazer's wonder, with, "Gentlemen, here's the skull of the stag. I was over, thank God, not under." The company broke out in applause. "By jingo, a lucky cripple! Have a munch of a grouse and a hunk of bread, and a tug besides at our tipple." "And there's my pay for your pluck," cried this, "and mine for a jolly story," cried that, while t'other, but he was drunk, hiccuped, "a trump, a Tory. I hope I gave twice as much as the rest, for, as Homer would say, within great, thou teeth kept tongue, my whole soul growled, rightly rewarded, ingrate." End of Donald. This recording is in the public domain.
Epilogue to Orsolando by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by April Gonzalez. Epilogue to Orsolando. At midnight in the silence of sleep time, when you set your fancies free, will they pass to where, by death, fools think, imprisoned, lo, he lies who once so loved you, whom you love so. Pity me? Oh, to love so, be so loved, yet so mistaken. What had I on earth to do with a slothful, with a mawkish, the unmanly, like the aimless, helpless, hopeless, did I drivel, being who? One who never turned his back but marched breast forward, never doubted clouds would break, never dreamed though right were worsted, wrong would triumph, held with fall to rise, or buffled to fight better, sleep to wake. No, at noonday, in the bustle of man's work time, greet the unseen with a cheer, bid him forward, breast and back as either should be, strive and thrive, cry, speed, fight on, fare ever, there as here. End of Epilogue to Orsolando. This recording is in a public domain.
Gold Hair, A Story of Pornique, by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Amanda Brewer. Oh, the beautiful girl, too white, who lived at Pornique, down by the sea, just where the sea and the Loire unite, and a boasted name in Brittany she bore, which I will not write. Too white, for the flower of life is red, her flesh was the soft, seraphic screen, of a soul that is meant, her parents said, to just see earth and hardly be seen, and blossom in heaven instead. Yet earth saw one thing, one how fair, one grace that grew to its full on earth. Smiles might be sparse on her cheek so spare, and her waist want half a girdle's girth, but she had her great gold hair. Hair such a wonder of flicks and floss, freshness and fragrance, floods of it too, Gold, did I say? Nay, gold's mere dross. Here, life smiled, think what I meant to do. And love sighed, fancy my loss. So when she died, it was scarce more strange than that when some delicate evening dies, and you follow its spent sun's pallid range, there's a shoot of color startles the skies with sudden, violent change. That, while the breath was nearly to seek, as they put the little cross to her lips, she changed, a spot came out on her cheek, a spark from her eye in mid-eclipse, and she broke forth, I must speak. Not my hair, made the girl her moan, all the rest is gone or to go, but the last, last grace, my all, my own, let it stay in the grave, that the ghosts may know. Leave my poor gold hair alone. The passion thus vented, dead lay she. Her parents sobbed their worst on that. All friends joined in, nor observed degree, for indeed the hair was to wonder at, as it spread, not flowing free. But curled around her brow like a crown, and coiled beside her cheeks like a cap, and calmed about her neck, aye, down to her breast, pressed flat, without a gap, is the gold, it reached her gown. All kissed that face like a silver wedge, mid the yellow wealth, nor disturbed its hair. Even the priest allowed death's privilege, as he planted the crucifix with care, on her breast, twixt edge and edge. And thus was she buried, inviolate, of body and soul, in the very space, by the altar, keeping saintly state, in Pornic church, for her pride of race, pure life, and piteous fate. And in after time would your fresh tear fall, though your mouth might twitch with a dubious smile, as they told you of gold both robe and pall, how she prayed them leave it alone a while, so it never was touched at all. Years flew, this legend grew at last, the life of the lady, all she had done, all been, in the memories fading fast, of lover and friend, was summed in one sentence, survivors past. To wit, she was meant for heaven, not earth, had turned an angel before the time, yet since she was mortal, in such dearth of frailty, all you could count a crime was she knew her gold hair's worth. At little pleasant Pornic church, it chanced, the pavement wanted repair, was taken to pieces, left in the lurch, a certain sacred space lay bare, and the boys began research. 'Twas the space where our sires would lay a saint, a benefactor, a bishop, suppose, a baron with armor adornments quaint, a dame with chaste ring and jeweled rose, things sanctity saves from taint. So we come to find them in after days, when the corpse is presumed to have done with gods of use to the living, in many ways, for the boys get pelf, and the town applauds, and the church deserves the praise. They grubbed with a will, and at length, O cor humanum, pectora sica, and the rest, they found no gods they were prying for, no ring, no rose, but who would have guessed, a double louis d'or. Here was a case for the priest, he heard, marked, inwardly digested, laid finger on nose, smiled, a little bird chirps in my ear, then, bring a spade, dig deeper, he gave the word. And lo, when they came to the coffin lid, or the rotten planks which composed it once, why, there lay the girl's skull, wedged amid a mint of money, it served for the nonce, to hold in its hair heaps hid. Hid there? Why? Could the girl be wont, she, the stainless soul, to treasure up money, earth's trash, and heaven's affront? Had a spider found out the communion cup? Was a toad in the christening font? Truth is truth. Too true it was. Gold. She hoarded and hugged it first, longed for it, leaned over it, loved it, alas, till the humor grew to a head and burst. And she cried at the final pass. Talk not of God, my heart is stone, nor lover nor friend, be gold for both. Gold I lack, and my all, my own, it shall hide in my hair. I scarce die loath if they let my hair alone. Louis d'ors, some 6 times 5, and duly double every piece. Now do you see, with the priest to shrive, with parents preventing her soul's release, by kisses that kept alive. With heaven's gold gates about to ope, with friend's praise gold-like lingering still, an instinct had bidden the girl's hand grope for gold, the true sort, gold in heaven, if you will. But I keep earth's too, I hope. Enough, the priest took the grave's grim yield. The parents, they eyed that price of sin, as if 30 pieces lay revealed on the place to bury strangers in, the hideous potter's field. But the priest bethought him, milk that's spilt, you know the adage, watch and pray. Saints tumble to earth with so slight a tilt. It would build a new altar, that we may, and the altar therewith was built. Why I deliver this horrible verse? As the text of a sermon which now I preach, evil or good may be better or worse in the human heart, but the mixture of each is a marvel and a curse. The candid incline to surmise of late that the Christian faith may be false, I find, for our essays and reviews debate begins to tell on the public mind, and Colenso's words have weight. I still, to suppose it true, for my part, see reasons and reasons, this to begin. 'Tis the faith that launched point-blank her dart at the head of a lie, taught original sin, the corruption of man's heart. End of Gold Hair, A Story of Pornique. This recording is in the public domain.
A Grammarian's Funeral, Shortly After the Revival of Learning, by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Martin Geeson, in Haslemere, Surrey. Let us begin and carry up this corpse, singing together. Leave we the common crofts, the vulgar thorps, each in its tether, sleeping safe on the bosom of the plain, cared for till cock-crow. Look out if yonder be not day again, rimming the rock-row. That's the appropriate country. There man's thought, rarer, intenser, self-gathered for an outbreak, as it ought, chafes in the censer. Leave we the unlettered plain its herd and crop. Seek we sepulture on a tall mountain, cityed to the top, crowded with culture. All the peaks soar, but one the rest excels. Clouds overcome it. No, yonder sparkle is the citadel's, circling its summit. Thither our path lies. Wind we up the heights. Wait ye the warning. Our low life was the levels and the nights. He's for the morning. Step to a tune, square chests erect each head. Where the beholders? This is our master, famous, calm and dead, borne on our shoulders. Sleep, crop and herd, sleep, darkling thorpe and croft, safe from the weather. He whom we convoy to his grave aloft, singing together, he was a man born with thy face and throat, lyric Apollo. Long he lived nameless. How should spring take note, winter would follow? Till lo, the little touch, and youth was gone. Cramped and diminished, moaned he, new measures, other feet anon. My dance is finished. No, that's the world's way. Keep the mountainside, make for the city. He knew the signal, and stepped on with pride over men's pity, left play for work, and grappled with the world, bent on escaping. "What's in the scroll?" quoth he, "thou keepest furled. Show me their shaping, theirs who most studied man, the bard and sage. Give." So he gowned him, straight got by heart that book to its last page. Learned we found him. Yea, but we found him bald too, eyes like lead, accents uncertain. "Time to taste life," another would have said, "up with the curtain." This man said rather, "Actual life comes next. Patience a moment. Grant I have mastered learning's crabbed text, still there's the comment. Let me know all. Prate not of most or least, painful or easy. Even to the crumbs I'd fain eat up the feast, I nor feel queasy." Oh, such a life as he resolved to live when he had learned it, when he had gathered all books had to give. Sooner he spurned it. Image the whole, then execute the parts. Fancy the fabric quite, ere you build, ere steel strike fire from quartz, ere mortar dab brick. Here's the town gate reached, there's the marketplace gaping before us. Yea, this in him was the peculiar grace. Hearten our chorus, that before living he'd learn how to live. No end to learning. Earn the means first. God surely will contrive use for our earning. Others mistrust and say, "But time escapes. Live now or never." He said, "What's time? Leave now for dogs and apes. Man has forever." Back to his book then, deeper drooped his head. Calculus racked him. Leaden before, his eyes grew dross of lead. Tussis attacked him. "Now, master, take a little rest." Not he. Caution redoubled. Step two abreast. The way winds narrowly. Not a whit troubled. Back to his studies, fresher than at first. Fierce as a dragon, he, soul hydroptic, with a sacred thirst, sucked at the flagon. Oh, if we draw a circle premature, heedless of far gain, greedy for quick returns of profit, sure bad is our bargain. Was it not great? Did not he throw on God? He loves the burthen. God's task to make the heavenly period perfect the earthen. Did not he magnify the mind, show clear just what it all meant? He would not discount life, as fools do hear, paid by instalment. He ventured neck or nothing, heaven's success found, or earth's failure. Wilt thou trust death or not? He answered, "Yes, hence with life's pale lure. That low man seeks a little thing to do, sees it and does it. This high man, with a great thing to pursue, dies ere he knows it. That low man goes on adding one to one, his hundred soon hit. This high man, aiming at a million, misses an unit. That has the world here. Should he need the next, let the world mind him. This throws himself on God, and unperplexed, seeking shall find him. So with the throttling hands of death at strife, ground he at grammar. Still through the rattle, parts of speech were rife. While he could stammer, he settled Hoti's business. Let it be. Properly based, un, gave us the doctrine of the enclitic day, dead from the waist down. Well, here's the platform. Here's the proper place. Hail to your purlieus, all ye high flyers of the feathered race, swallows and curlews. Here's the top peak. The multitude below live, for they can, there. This man decided not to live, but no. Bury this man there. Here, here's his place, where meteors shoot, clouds form, lightnings are loosened, stars come and go. Let joy break with the storm. Peace let the dew send. Lofty designs must close in like effects. Loftily lying, leave him. Still loftier than the world suspects, living and dying. End of A Grammarian's Funeral, shortly after the revival of learning. This recording is in the public domain.
Home Thoughts from Abroad by Robert Browning. Read for LibriVox.org by April Gonzalez. Cavite, Philippines. Home Thoughts from Abroad. Oh, to be in England, now that April's there, and whoever wakes in England sees some morning unaware. Put the lowest buffs in a brushwood sheaf, round the elm tree bole or in tiny leaf, while the chaffinches sing on the orchard buff. In England, now, and up to April, when May follows, and the white throat builds, and all the swallows. Hark, I wear my blossom pear tree in the hedge, leans to the field, and scatters on a clover, blossoms and dewdrops, at the bent spray's edge. That's the wise thrush. He sings each song twice over, lest he should think he never could recapture the first fine careless rapture. And though the fields look rough with hoary dew, all will be gay when noontide wakes anew. The buttercups, the little children's dower, far brighter than this gaudy melon flower. End of Home Thoughts from Abroad. This recording's in the public domain.
How They Brought the Good News from Ghent to Aix by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Patrick Wallace. I sprang to the stirrup, and Yoris and he. I galloped, Dirk galloped, we galloped all three. Good speed, cried the watch as the gate-bolts undrew. Speed echoed the wall to us galloping through. Behind shut the postern, the lights sank to rest, and into the midnight we galloped abreast. Not a word to each other, we kept the great pace, neck by neck, stride by stride, never changing our place. I turned in my saddle and made its girth tight, then shortened each stirrup and set the peak right, rebuckled the check-strap, chained slacker the bit, nor galloped less steadily Roland a whit. 'Twas moonset at starting, but while we drew near Locrum, the cocks crew, and twilight dawned clear. At Boom a great yellow star came out to see. At Düffelt 'twas morning as plain as could be. And from Mechelen church steeple we heard the half-chime, so Yoris broke silence with, "Yet there is time." At Arscott upleaped of a sudden the sun, and against him the cattle stood black, every one, to stare through the mist at us galloping past. And I saw my stout galloper Roland at last, with resolute shoulders, each butting away the haze as some bluff river headland its spray. and his low head and crest, just one sharp ear bent back for my voice, and the other pricked out on his track, and one eye's black intelligence, ever that glance o'er its white edge at me, his own master, askance. And the thick heavy spume flakes, which aye and anon his fierce lips shook upwards in galloping on. By Hasselt Dirk groaned, and cried, "Joris, stay, spur! Your Rose galloped bravely, the fault's not in her. We'll remember at X." For one heard the quick wheeze of her chest, saw the stretched neck and staggering knees, and sunk tail and horrible heave of the flank, as down on her haunches she shuddered and sank. So we were left galloping, Joris and I, past Loos and past Tongres, no cloud in the sky. The broad sun above laughed a pitiless laugh, neath our feet broke the brittle bright stubble like chaff, till over by Delhem a domed spire sprung white, and "Gallop," gasped Joris, "for X is in sight. How they'll greet us!" And all in a moment his roan rolled neck and croup over, lay dead as a stone. And there was my Roland to bear the whole weight of the news which alone could save X from her fate, with his nostrils like pits full of blood to the brim, and with circles of red for his eye-socket's rim. Then I cast loose my buff-coat, each holster let fall, shook off both my jack-boots, let go belt and all, stood up in the stirrup, leaned, patted his ear, called my Roland his pet name, my horse without peer, clapped my hands, laughed and sung, any noise, bad or good, till at length into X Roland galloped and stood. And all I remember is friends flocking around, as I sat with his head twixt my knees on the ground. And no voice but was praising this Roland of mine, as I poured down his throat our last measure of wine, which, the burgesses voted by common consent, was no more than his due, who brought good news from Ghent. End of How They Brought the Good News from Ghent to X. This recording is in the public domain.
Robert Browning, The Lost Leader, read for LibriVox.org by Michael Dowling. Just for a handful of silver he left us, just for a ribbon to stick in his coat, found the one gift of which fortune bereft us, lost all the others she lets us devote. They, with the gold to give, doled him out silver. So much was theirs, who so little allowed. How all our copper had gone for his service, rags, were they purple, his heart had been proud. We that had loved him so, followed him, honoured him, lived in his mild and magnificent eye, learned his great language, caught his clear accents, made him our pattern to live and to die. Shakespeare was of us, Milton was for us, Burns, Shelley were with us, they watch from their graves. He alone breaks from the van and the freemen, he alone sinks to the rear and the slaves. We shall march prospering, not through his presence. Songs may inspirit us, not from his lyre. Deeds will be done while he boasts his quiescence, still bidding crouch whom the rest bad aspire. Blot out his name, then. Record one lost soul more, one task more declined, one more footpath untrod, one more devil's triumph and sorrow for angels, one wrong more to man, one more insult to God. Life's night begins, let him never come back to us. There would be doubt, hesitation, and pain, forced praise on our part, the glimmer of twilight, never glad, confident morning again. Best fight on well, for we taught him, strike gallantly, menace our heart, ere we master his own. Then let him receive the new knowledge and wait us, pardoned in heaven, the first by the throne. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Love Among the Ruins by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Patty Cunningham, February 18th, 2012. Where the quiet colored end of evening smiles, miles and miles, on the solitary pastures where our sheep, half asleep, tinkle homeward through the twilight, stray or stop as they crop, was the site once of a city great and gay, so they say, of our country's very capital,
Its prince, ages since, held his court in, gathered councils, wielding far peace or war. Now the country does not even boast a tree, as you see, to distinguish slopes of verdure. Certain rills from the hills intersect and give a name to, else they run into one, where the domed and daring palace shot its spires up like fires, or the hundred-gated circuit of a wall, bounding all, made of marble, men might march on, nor be pressed, 12 abreast. And such plenty and perfection, see, of grass never was. Such a carpet as this summer-time spreads and embeds, every vestige of the city, guest alone, stock or stone, where a multitude of men breathed joy and woe long ago. Lust of glory pricked their hearts up, dread of shame struck them tame, and that glory and that shame alike, the gold bought and sold. Now the single little turret that remains on the plains, by the caper overrooted, by the gourd overscored, while the patching house-leek's head of blossom winks through the chinks, marks the basement whence a tower in ancient times sprang sublime, and a burning ring all around the chariots traced as they raced, and the monarch and his minions and his dames viewed the games. And I know, while thus the quiet colored eve smiles to leave to their folding all our many tinkling fleece in such peace, and the slopes and rills in undistinguished gray melt away, that a girl with eager eyes and yellow hair waits me there, in the turret whence the charioteers caught soul for the goal, when the king looked, where she looks now, breathless dumb, till I come. But he looked upon the city every side, far and wide, all the mountains topped with temples, all the glades colonnades, all the causeys, bridges, aqueducts, and then all the men. When I do come, she will speak not. She will stand, either hand on my shoulder, give her eyes the first embrace of my face, ere we rush, ere we extinguish sight and speech, each on each. In 1 year they sent 1,000,000 fighters forth, south and north, and they built their gods a brazen pillar high as the sky, yet reserved 1,000 chariots in full force, gold, of course. O heart, O blood that freezes, blood that burns, earth's returns for whole centuries of folly, noise, and sin, shut them in with their triumphs and their glories and the rest. Love is best. End of Love Among the Ruins. This recording is in the public domain.
Mesmerism by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Martin Giessen, in Haslemere, Surrey. All I believed is true. I am able yet all I want to get by a method as strange as new. Dare I trust the same to you? If at night, when doors are shut and the woodworm picks, and the death watch ticks, and the bar has a flag of smut, and a cat's in the water butt, and the socket floats and flares, and the house beams groan, and a foot unknown is surmised on the garret stairs, and the locks slip unawares, and the spider, to serve his ends by a sudden thread, arms and legs outspread, on the table's midst descends, comes to find God knows what friends. If, since Eve drew in, I say, I have sat and brought, so to speak, my thought to bear on the woman away, till I felt my hair turn grey, till I seemed to have and hold in the vacancy twixt the wall and me, from the hair plait's chestnut gold to the foot in its muslin fold, have and hold then and there, her, from head to foot, breathing and mute, passive and yet aware, in the grasp of my steady stare, hold and have, there and then, all her body and soul that completes my whole, all that women add to men, in the clutch of my steady ken, having and holding, till I imprint her fast on the void at last, as the sun does whom he will by the calotypist's skill. Then, if my heart's strength serve, and through all and each of the veils I reach to her soul, and never swerve, knitting an iron nerve, command her soul to advance, and inform the shape which has made escape, and before my countenance answers me glance for glance, I, still with a gesture fit of my hands that best do my soul's behest, pointing the power from it, while myself do steadfast sit, steadfast and still the same on my object bent, while the hands give vent to my ardour and my aim and break into very flame. Then I reach, I must believe, not her soul in vain, for to me again it reaches, and past retrieve is wound in the toils I weave, and must follow as I require, as befits a thrall, bringing flesh and all, essence and earth attire, to the source of the tractile fire, till the house called hers, not mine, with a growing weight seems to suffocate, if she break not its leaden line and escape from its close confine, out of doors into the night, onto the maze of the wild wood ways, not turning to left nor right from the pathway, blind with sight, making through rain and wind o'er the broken shrubs, twixt the stems and stubs, with a still, composed, strong mind, nor a care for the world behind, swifter and still more swift, as the crowding peace doth to joy increase in the wide blind eyes uplift through the darkness and the drift, while I, to the shape, I too feel my soul dilate nor a whit abate, and relax not a gesture due as I see my belief come true. For there have I drawn, or no, life to that lip? Do my fingers dip in a flame, which again they throw on the cheek that breaks a glow? Ah, was the hair so first? What, unfilleted, made alive, and spread through the void with a rich outburst, chestnut gold interspersed? Like the doors of a casket shrine, see on either side her two arms divide, till the heart betwixt makes sign, take me, for I am thine. Now, now, the door is heard, hark, the stairs, and near, nearer, and here, now, and at call the third, she enters without a word. On doth she march, and on to the fancied shape. It is past escape, herself now. The dream is done, and the shadow and she are one. First I will pray, do thou that ownest the soul,
yet wilt grant control to another, nor disallow for a time. Restrain me now. I admonish me while I may, not to squander guilt, since require thou wilt at my hand its price one day. What the price is, who can say? End of Mesmerism. This recording is in the public domain.
My Last Duchess by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Rhonda Fetterman. Ferrara. That's my last duchess painted on the wall, looking as if she were alive. I call that piece a wonder now. Fra Pandolf's hands worked busily a day, and there she stands. Wilt please you sit and look at her? I said Fra Pandolf by design, for never read strangers like you that pictured countenance, the depth and passion of its earnest glance. But to myself they turned, since none puts by the curtain I have drawn for you but I, and seemed as they would ask me, if they durst, how such a glance came there. So not the first are you to turn and ask thus. Sir, 'twas not her husband's presence only called that spot of joy into the duchess's cheek. Perhaps Fra Pandolf chanced to say, her mantle laps over my lady's wrists too much, or paint must never hope to reproduce the faint half-flush that dies along her throat. Such stuff was courtesy, she thought, and cause enough for calling up that spot of joy. She had a heart, how shall I say, too soon made glad, too easily impressed. She liked whate'er she looked on, and her looks went everywhere. Sir, 'twas all one, my favor at her breast, the dropping of the daylight in the west. The bough of cherries some officious fool broke in the orchard for her, the white mule she rode with round the terrace, all and each would draw from her alike the approving speech, or blush at least. She thanked men good, but thanked somehow, I know not how, as if she ranked my gift of a 900-years-old name with anybody's gift. Who'd stoop to blame this sort of trifling? Even had you skill in speech, which I have not, to make your will quite clear to such an one, and say, just this or that in you disgusts me. Here you miss, or there exceed the mark. And if she let herself be lessoned so, nor plainly set her wits to yours, forsooth and made excuse, e'en that would be some stooping, and I choose never to stoop. Oh, sir, she smiled, no doubt, whene'er I passed her, but who passed without much the same smile? This grew. I gave commands. Then all smiles stopped altogether. There she stands, as if alive. Will it please you rise? We'll meet the company below, then. I repeat, the Count, your master's known munificence is ample warrant that no just pretense of mine for dowry will be disallowed. Though his fair daughter's self, as I avowed at starting, is my object. Nay, we'll go together down, sir. Notice Neptune, though, taming a seahorse, thought a rarity, which Klaus of Innsbruck cast in bronze for me. End of My Last Duchess. This recording is in the public domain. My Star by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Rhonda Fetterman. All that I know of a certain star is it can throw like the angled spar. Now a dart of red, now a dart of blue, till my friends have said they would fain see too my star that dartles the red and the blue. Then it stops like a bird, like a flower hangs furled. They must solace themselves with the Saturn above it. What matter to me if their star is a world? Mine has opened its soul to me. Therefore I love it. End of My Star. This recording is in the public domain.
Now, by Robert Browning. Read for LibriVox.org by Amy Graymore. Houlton, Maine. www.amysmindtoyourmind.com. Out of your whole life give but a moment, all of your life that has gone before, all to come after it, so you ignore. So you make perfect the present, condense, in a rapture of rage for perfection's endowment, thought and feeling and soul and sense, merged in a moment, which gives me at last, you around me for once, you beneath me, above me. Me, sure that despite of time future, time past, this tick of our lifetimes, one moment, you love me. How long such suspension may linger? Ah, sweet, the moment eternal, just that and no more, when ecstasy's utmost we clutch at the core, while cheeks burn, arms open, eyes shut, and lips meet. End of Now. This recording is in the public domain.
Pan and Luna by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Martin Geeson, in Haslemere, Surrey. Si credere digno est. Virgil, Georgics, Book 3, line 390. Oh, worthy of belief, I hold it was, Virgil, your legend in those strange three lines. No question, that adventure came to pass one black night in Arcadia. Yes, the pines, mountains, and valleys mingling made one mass of black with void black heaven. The earth's confines, the sky's embrace, below, above, around, all hardened into black without a bound. Fill up a swart stone chalice to the brim with fresh squeezed yet fast thickening poppy juice. See how the sluggish jelly, late a swim, turns marble to the touch of one who would loose the solid smooth, grown jet from rim to rim, by turning round the bowl. So night can fuse earth with her all-comprising sky. No less, light, the least spark, shows air and emptiness. And thus it proved, when, diving into space, stripped of all vapour, from each web of mist, utterly film-free, entered on her race the naked moon, full-orbed antagonist of night and dark night's dowry. Peak to base upstarted mountains, and each valley, kissed to sudden life, lay silver bright. In air flew she, revealed, made moon with limbs all bare. Still as she fled, each depths, where refuge seemed, opening a lone pale chamber, left distinct those limbs. Mid still retreating blue, she teemed herself with whiteness, virginal, unsynced by any halo, save what finely gleamed to outline, not disguise her. Heaven was linked in one accord with earth to quaff the joy, drain beauty to the dregs without alloy.
whereof she grew aware. What help, when lo, a succorable cloud with sleep lay dense? Some pine tree top had caught it sailing slow, and tethered for a prize. In evidence, captive lay fleece on fleece of piled-up snow, drowsily patient. Flake heaped how or whence, the structure of that succorable cloud, what matter? Shamed, she plunged into its shroud. Orbed, so the woman figure poets call, because of rounds on rounds, that apple-shaped head, which its hair binds close into a ball, each side the curving ears, that pure, undraped pout of the sister paps, that, once for all say, her consummate circle thus escaped with its innumerous circlets, sank absorbed, safe in the cloud. O naked moon, full orbed! But what means this? The downy swathes combine, conglobe, the smothery, coy caressing stuff curdles about her. Vain each twist and twine those lithe limbs try, encroached on by a fluff fitting as close as fits the dented spine its flexible ivory outside flesh. Enough! The plumy drifts contract, condense, constringe, till she is swallowed by the feathery springe. As when a pearl slips lost in the thin foam churned on a seashore, and o'er frost conceits herself safe housed in Amphitrite's dome. If through the bladdery wave-worked yeast she meets what most she loathes and leaps from, elf from gnome no gladlier, finds that safest of retreats bubble about a treacherous hand wide ope to grasp her. Divers who pick pearls so grope. So lay this maid moon, clasped around and caught by rough red Pan, the god of all that tract. He it was schemed the snare, thus subtly wrought with simulated earth breath, wool tufts packed into a billowy wrappage. Sheep far sought for spotless shearings yield such. Take the fact as learned Virgil gives it, how the breed whitens itself forever. Yes, indeed. If one forefather ram, though pure as chalk from tinge on fleece, should still display a tongue black neath the beast's moist palate, prompt men balk the propagating plague. He gets no young, they rather slay him, sell his hide to caulk ships with, first steeped with pitch, nor hands are wrung in sorrow for his fate. Protected thus, the purity we loved is gained for us. So did girl moon, by just her attribute of unmatched modesty, betrayed, lie trapped, bruised to the breast of Pan, half god, half brute, raked by his bristly boar sword, while he lapped, never say kissed her, that were to pollute love's language, which, moreover, proves unapt to tell how she recoiled, as who finds thorns where she sought flowers, when, feeling, she touched horns. Then, does the legend say, first moon eclipse happened, first swooning fit which puzzled sore the early sages? Is that why she dips into the dark a minute and no more? Only so long as serves her while she rips the cloud's womb through, and faultless as before pursues her way. No lesson for a maid left she, a maid herself thus trapped, betrayed. Ah, Virgil, tell the rest you. To the deep of his domain the wildwood Pan forthwith called her, and so she followed. In her sleep, surely, by no means spurning him. The myth explain who may. Let all else go. I keep, as of a ruin, just a monolith, thus much, one verse of five words, each a boon. Arcadia, night, a cloud, Pan, and the moon. End of Pan and Luna. This recording is in the public domain.
Porphyria's Lover by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Rhonda Fetterman. The rain set early in tonight. The sullen wind was soon awake. It tore the elm tops down for spite and did its worst to vex the lake. I listened with heart fit to break. When glided in Porphyria, straight she shut the cold out and the storm, and kneeled and made the cheerless grate blaze up, and all the cottage warm. Which done, she rose and from her form withdrew the dripping cloak and shawl, and laid her soiled gloves by, untied her hat, and let the damp hair fall. And last she sat down by my side, and called me. When no voice replied, she put my arm about her waist, and made her smooth white shoulder bare, and all her yellow hair displaced, and stooping made my cheek lie there, and spread o'er all her yellow hair. Murmuring how she loved me, she too weak for all her heart's endeavor to set its struggling passion free from pride and vainer ties to sever, and give herself to me forever. But passion sometimes would prevail, nor could tonight's gay feast restrain a sudden thought of one so pale for love of her, and all in vain. So she was come through wind and rain. Be sure I looked up at her eyes, happy and proud. At last I knew Porphyria worshipped me. Surprise made my heart swell, and still it grew while I debated what to do. That moment she was mine, mine fair, perfectly pure and good. I found a thing to do, and all her hair in one long yellow string I wound three times her little throat around, and strangled her. No pain felt she. I am quite sure she felt no pain. As a shut bud that holds a bee, I warily oped her lids. Again laughed the blue eyes without a stain, and I untightened next the tress about her neck. Her cheek once more blushed bright beneath my burning kiss. I propped her head up as before, only this time my shoulder bore her head, which droops upon it still. The smiling, rosy little head, so glad it has its utmost will, that all it scorned at once is fled, and I, its love, am gained instead. Porphyria's love. She guessed not how her darling one wish would be heard. And thus we sit together now, and all night long we have not stirred, and yet God has not said a word. End of Porphyria's Lover. This recording is in the public domain.
Prospice by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by April Gonzalez, 23rd of February, Cavite, Philippines. Prospice. Fear death, to feel the fog in my throat, the mist in my face, where the snows begin, and the blast denote, I am nearing the place. The power of the night, the press of the storm, the pose of the foe, where he stands, the arch fair in a visible form. Yet the strong man must go, for the journey is done and the summit attained, and the barriers fall. Though a battle's to fight ere the guerdon be gained, the reward of it all. I was ever a fighter, so won't fight more. The best and the last. I would hate that death bandaged my eyes, and forbore, and bade me creep past. No, let me taste the whole of it, fare like my peers, the heroes of old. Bear the brunt, in a minute pay glad life's arrears, of pain, darkness, and cold. For sudden the worst turns the best to the brave, the black minutes at end, and the elements rage, the thin voices that rave, shall dwindle, shall blend, shall change, shall become first peace out of pain, then a light, then thy breast. O thou soul of my soul, I shall clasp thee again, and with God be the rest. End of Prospice. This recording is in a public domain.
Soliloquy of the Spanish Cloister by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Martin Geeson, in Hazelmere, Surrey. Grr, there go, my heart's abhorrence. Water your damned flower-pots, do. Oh, if hate killed men, brother Lawrence, God's blood would not mine kill you. What, your myrtle-bush wants trimming? Oh, that rose has prior claims. Needs its leaden vase filled brimming. Hell dry you up with its flames. At the meal we sit together. Salve tibi, I must hear wise talk of the kind of weather, sort of season, time of year. Not a plenteous cork crop, scarcely dare we hope oak calls, I doubt. What's the Latin name for parsley? What's the Greek name for swine snout? Phew, we'll have our platter burnished, laid with care on our own shelf, with a fire new spoon we're furnished, and a goblet for ourself, rinsed like something sacrificial, ere 'tis fit to touch our chaps, marked with L for our initial. Heh, there his lily snaps. Saint, forsooth, while brown Dolores squats outside the convent bank with Sanchicha, telling stories, steeping tresses in the tank, blue-black, lustrous, thick like horsehairs. Can't I see his dead eye glow, bright as 'twere a Barbary corsair's? That is, if he'd let it show. When he finishes refection, knife and fork he never lays crosswise, to my recollection, as do I in Jesus' praise. I the Trinity illustrate, drinking watered orange pulp, in three sips the Arian frustrate, while he drains his at one gulp. Oh, those melons!
If he's able, we're to have a feast, so nice. One goes to the abbot's table, all of us get each a slice. How go on your flowers? None double, not one fruit sort can you spy. Strange! And I, too, at such trouble, keep them close nipped on the sly. There's a great text in Galatians, once you trip on it, entails 29 distinct damnations, one sure if another fails. If I trip him just a dying, sure of heaven as sure can be, spin him round and send him flying off to hell, a manichee. Or my scrofulous French novel on grey paper with blunt type. Simply glance at it, you grovel hand and foot in Belial's gripe. If I double down its pages at the woeful 16th print, when he gathers his green gauges, oh, perceive and slip it in. Or there's Satan. One might venture, pledge one's soul to him, yet leave such a flaw in the indenture as he'd miss till past retrieve. Blasted lay that rose acacia we're so proud of. Hi, zi, hein. There's vespers. Plena gracia, ave virgo. Grrr, you swine. End of Soliloquy of the Spanish Cloister. This recording is in the public domain.
Song by Robert Browning, read for LibriVox.org by Michael Dowling. Nay, but you, who do not love her, is she not pure gold, my mistress? Holds earth aught, speak truth, above her, aught like this tress, see, and this tress, and this last fairest tress of all, so fair, see, ere I let it fall. Because you spend your lives in praising, to praise, you search the wide world over, then why not witness, calmly gazing, if earth holds aught, speak truth, above her, above this tress, and this I touch, but cannot praise, I love so much. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Speculative by Robert Browning. Read for LibriVox.org by Amy Graymore, Holton, Maine, www.amysmindtoyourmind.com. Others may need new life in heaven, man, nature, art, made new assume, man with new mind, old sense to leaven, nature, new light to clear, old gloom, art that breaks bounds, gets soaring room. I shall pray, fugitive as precious, minutes which passed, return, remain, let earth's old life once more enmesh us, you with old pleasure, me, old pain, so we but meet nor part again. End of Speculative. This recording is in the public domain.
Summum Bonum by Robert Browning. Read for LibriVox.org by Amanda Brewer. All the breath and the bloom of the year in the bag of one bee. All the wonder and wealth of the mine in the heart of one gem. In the core of one pearl. All the shade and the shine of the sea. Breath and bloom, shade and shine, wonder, wealth, and, how far above them, truth that's brighter than gem, trust that's purer than pearl. Brightest truth, purest trust in the universe, all were, for me, in the kiss of one girl. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
A Tale by Robert Browning. read for LibriVox.org by Algie Pug, Perth, Western Australia. A tale, epilogue to the two poets of Croisic. "What a pretty tale you told me once upon a time. Said you found it somewhere. Scold me. Was it prose or was it rhyme? Greek or Latin? Greek, you said, while your shoulder propped my head. Anyhow, there's no forgetting this much, if no more, that a poet, pray, no petting, yes, a bard, sir, famed of yore, went where such like used to go, singing for a prize, you know. Well, he had to sing, not merely sing, but play the lyre. Playing was important clearly, quite as singing. I desire, sir, you keep the fact in mind for a purpose that's behind. There stood he, while deep attention held the judges round. Judges able, I should mention, to detect the slightest sound sung or played amiss. Such ears had all judges, it appears. Nonetheless, he sang out boldly, played in time and tune, till the judges, weighing coldly each note's worth, seemed, late or soon, sure to smile. In vain one tries, picking faults out, take the prize. When? A mischief! Were they 7 strings the lyre possessed? Oh, and afterwards 11. Thank you. Well, sir, who had guessed such ill luck in store? It happed one of those same 7 strings snapped. All was lost, then? No. A cricket? What, cicada? Pooh! Some mad thing that left its thicket for mere love of music, flew with its little heart on fire, lighted on the crippled lyre. So that when, ah, joy, our singer for his truant string feels with disconcerted finger, but what does cricket else but fling fiery heart forth, sound the note wanted by the throbbing throat? Aye, and ever to the ending, cricket chirps at need, executes the hands intending, promptly, perfectly, indeed, saves the singer from defeat with her chirrup low and sweet. Till, at ending, all the judges cry with one assent, take the prize, a prize who grudges such a voice and instrument? Why, we took your lyre for harp, so it shrilled us forth F-sharp. Did the conqueror spurn the creature once its service done? That's no such uncommon feature in the case where music's sun finds its lotter's power too spent for aiding soul's development. No, this other, on returning homeward, prize in hand, satisfied his bosom's yearning. Sir, I hope you understand, said, some record there must be of this cricket's help to me. So he made himself a statue, marble stood, life-size, on the lyre, he pointed at you, perched his partner in the prize. Never more apart you found her, he throned, from him she crowned. That's the tale. Its application? Somebody I know hopes one day for reputation through his poetry that's, oh, all so learned and so wise, and deserving of a prize. If he gains one, will some ticket, when his statue's built, tell the gazer, 'twas a cricket helped by crippled lyre, whose lilt sweet and low when strength usurped, softness placed in the scale she chirped. For, as victory was nighest, while I sang and played, with my lyre at lowest, highest, right alike, one string that made love sound soft was snapped in twain, never to be heard again. Had not a kind cricket fluttered, perched upon the place vacant left, and duly uttered, love, 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 whene'er the bass asked the treble to atone for its somewhat sombre drone. But you don't know music, wherefore keep on casting pearls to a poet? All I care for is to tell him that a girl's love comes aptly in when gruff grows his singing. There, enough. End of A Tale by Robert Browning. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain.
White Witchcraft by Robert Browning. Read for LibriVox.org by Amy Graymore. Holton, Maine. www.amysmindtoyourmind.com. If you and I could change to beasts, what beast should either be?
Shall you and I play Jove for once? Turn fox, then I decree. Shy wild, sweet stealer of the grapes, now do your worst on me. And thus you think to spite your friend, turned loathsome, what a toad. So all men shrink and shun me, dear men pursue your road. Leave but my crevice in the stone, a reptile's fit abode. Now say your worst, Canidia. He's loathsome, I allow. There may or may not lurk a pearl beneath his puckered brow. But see his eyes that follow mine, love lasts there anyhow. End of White Witchcraft. This recording is in the public domain.
Why I Am a Liberal. Read for LibriVox.org by Martin Geeson in Hazelmere, Surrey. Why? Because all I haply can and do, all that I am now, all I hope to be, whence comes it, save from fortune setting free body and soul, the purpose to pursue, God traced for both? If fetters, not a few, of prejudice, convention, fall from me, these shall I bid men, each in his degree also God guided, bear, and gaily too. But little do or can the best of us, that little is achieved through liberty. Who then dares hold, emancipated thus, his fellow shall continue bound? Not I, who live, love, labour freely, nor discuss a brother's right to freedom. That is why. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
A Woman's Last Word by Robert Browning. Read for LibriVox.org by Rhonda Fetterman. Let's contend no more, love. Strive nor weep. All be as before, love. Only sleep. What so wild as words are? I and thou in debate, as birds are, hawk on bough. See the creature stalking while we speak. Hush and hide the talking, cheek on cheek. What so false as truth is, false to thee? Where the serpent's tooth is, shun the tree. Where the apple reddens, never pry, lest we lose our Edens, Eve and I. Be a god and hold me with a charm. Be a man and fold me with thine arm. Teach me, only teach, love. As I ought, I will speak thy speech, love. Think thy thought. Meet if thou require it, both demands, laying flesh and spirit in thy hands. That shall be tomorrow, not tonight. I must bury sorrow out of sight. Must a little weep, love, foolish me, and so fall asleep, love, loved by thee.
End of A Woman's Last Word. This recording is in the public domain.